block the fire aisle. Do not block the aisle. The fire marshal will come. I don't need him to. I don't need him added to my list.
You're on everybody's list.
I know. All right. Got a few things in to go over. One, we have a huge class here at Beyond Capacity. So I really do truly try to get to everybody's questions to the best of my ability. In order for me to do that though, just raise your hand and I'll try to get to you. If I don't get to you, it's not because, you know, for any other reason than I have a lot of hands. So also, if I don't get to you in class, you know, I'll try to stay after, or you can always come to my office hours. But I want to make sure that all questions are answered by the time all the answers are given. No, all questions are fleshed out by the time you leave. Okay, that's the first one. Second one, no sitting in the aisles. I think it's okay to have people in the corner there. I think that's okay. But as long as we're not in the aisles, we're cool. Yeah, you have to be registered. Third thing is you have to be registered to be in the class or just have the form. And it's no problem, I'll sign the form. Not a problem at all. Just a reminder to complete the sheet that I passed out last class, and it'll just give you a fairly good indicator of how your thoughts change over the term of the 10 weeks. And we will revisit that. Okay, next item on the list. For the attendance sheet, try to sign the same number. Like if you're 125 or whatever, it just makes Renee's life much easier. We want to make Renee's life easier, don't we?
Yes, of course.
Excellent. I did some reading. I would have liked to have done more blasphemy, and we will. I think it's week 9 or week 10. I did some reading last night for actually a few hours on it, and I came across some interesting things on both sides of the equation. One was Sean Faircloth's talk he gave is exceptionally detailed. And I would recommend that I tweeted that. And we'll talk about this later on, but again, it's a hot topic now. My guess is it's going to be a hot topic in a few months. I don't know. All right, next item. So I just want to say that not everybody will agree with a lot of the concepts that we're talking about, so don't sneer or snicker or whatever if an idea comes up that you find unpalatable. We'll talk about it, and that's especially true when the guest lecturers come in, but you already knew that. I thought I'd just say that anyway. Somebody emailed me and asked me if I could read something I've written on the subject. I have no possible idea why anybody would want me to do that. But yeah, if it's appropriate, maybe week 7 or 8 or something, if someone finds some odd urgency in that. I can't imagine why someone would find that so appealing. But yeah, that's fine. All right. Very brief review of what we did yesterday while we fill our thumb drives and before the guest lecturer comes in. We talked about new atheism versus old atheism. Thanks for making the sheet up. We talked about new atheism versus old atheism and the difference between insufficient evidence versus rational and delusional thinking and claiming that this is an irrational move. And then we also talked about a possible reaction to that, why new atheism has come to the fore. I also talked about blasphemy for not anywhere nearly as long as I would have liked to, but one of the deliverables was, when does something constitute blasphemy? Usually there's an idea of sacred, and then there's an idea of something profaning that. And then I talked about how it's unclear if somebody doesn't buy into a system, it's unclear that that's blasphemy. And then we talked about that. I made a ridiculous math mistake. Thank you for correcting me. I think it was like 25 million or so. I mean, I was way off, but I don't pretend to know things I don't know about math. It's a good thing this isn't a math class. But the joke would be on you, wouldn't it? Yeah, and I talked a little bit about the idea of tolerance and the left. This is something I've been thinking about for a long time, and a part of what we're going to do if you take that anti-apologetics class is I've written a piece for my book about how criticizing bad ideas has been turned into an immoral act. So a critique of an idea or a criticism of an idea is then twisted into something immoral that one ought not to do. It's twisted into a moral issue, from an epistemological critique to a moral issue. We'll talk about that week 9, but that was the other deliverable. And then some terms that I'd like to flesh out. I really appreciate this, thanks. Mm-hmm. You put this together. Some terms that I'd like to flesh out: morality, metaphysics, epistemology, and ontology. So let's start with morality. Any guesses?
Ought not, right and wrong.
Yeah, what one ought or ought not to do. That's the definition I prefer. It's just the simplest, easiest definition. What one ought to do.
Does anybody else need a thumb drive?
Perfect. Thumb drives, keep it coming. I've budgeted 15 minutes for this, so talk freely amongst yourself. This is just the intro. Then we talked about metaphysics, M-E-T-A, physics, metaphysics. Metaphysics is, you know, in a sense, it's beyond physics, but it's the furniture of the world. It's the stuff in the world. It's what there is. It's objects. It's those things that aren't your ideas that are external. And then we talked about epistemology. It's one of my favorite subjects. Epistemology is how one knows what one knows. The study of knowledge. How one knows what one knows. There's also things like meta-epistemology, like the study of knowledge, etc. And then we talked a little bit about ontology, which we won't really talk about too much in here, but that's basically the study of being. I don't usually use the word ontology because I don't really like the word being. I'm not really sure what it means. But that's pretty much how people define that. So the main branches of philosophy are morality, metaphysics, and epistemology. So that covers the review. All right, any questions before we rock and roll? Okay, so I want to introduce our guest lecturer today. He's a very, very dear friend of mine. When I have this is true, this is from the bottom of my heart. When I have a question about philosophy, this is the man I ask the question to. His name is Steve Goldman. He publishes under Stephen Brutus, and I asked him why, and he said, because there are many Steve Goldmans in the phone book, but very, very few Stephen Brutuses. So I've just finished reading his forthcoming book, which is about religion and faith and atheism. So he's going to talk to us about the history of atheism. Please give him a warm round of applause.
So, thank you. It's warm in here.
It is. Yeah.
So, my name is Steve Goldman, and I'm very happy to be here. And you know, I have a lot of material to cover today. There's a long history that we're going to go over, but please interrupt me as I'm speaking if something comes up and you'd like to ask a question. We'll try to have a communicative session here. I should say, you know, something about myself. I've been teaching philosophy and comparative religion for many years, for decades, and I'm honored to be here with Professor Boghossian, and I invite you all into the subject of philosophy if you are new to this subject, and perhaps it will be some use to you in your lives. You know, I thought maybe I would start by saying something sort of funny, if I have that ability, which is that this is a serious, you know, contentious, troublesome subject that engages the emotions. So if we can sort of round up our sense of humor at the beginning of this class, and as you're studying this difficult subject, then you're ahead of the game. You know, the term atheism is used in secular contexts before we start talking about religion. And, you know, it maybe has the sense of just losing your commitment to something. A friend of mine who is who's getting divorced right now for the second time told me the other day that he's becoming an atheist about marriage. So I think, you know, in secular contexts, in baseball, for example, or in, you know, in everyday life, you might lose your belief in something. You might struggle with your belief in something. You might get it back. But, you know, so in those circumstances, you know, you can imagine circumstances that would impinge upon your belief, that would help your belief, that would help take it away. I'm just encouraging you to think somewhat in those terms, you know, from a secular point of view to begin with, thinking about this word as a way of getting into our subject. So one of the most important points that I'll make today is that this subject is part of a twin. You know, there's atheism and there's theism. They don't exist apart from one another. And you know, the term polemic, polemos in Greek, having to do with contesting theses about the same subject. You know, in everyday context, we disagree about politics, red state, blue state, or about issues of the day, about whether gay people should be allowed to be married. Some people argue yes, some people argue no. These sides, as it were, of a question go together, and you know, you'd be lonely if you had a point of view here, but no one to argue with. And the idea of atheism, I'm trying to suggest, is part of this half, one half of this controversy. And for that reason, you know, whenever you take a position on this issue, you are you're sort of dependent on what your partner in conversation has to say. If they are talking about theism, let's say, as an open-hearted love of life, then atheism would be a more skeptical position. If they're talking about theism as an otherworldliness, then atheism might impress you as a this-worldly kind of focus, as a terrestrial focus, as being focused on this life. In any case, I'm trying to just impress upon you that this subject that you're beginning to study in this class is a contentious subject, and it's always a good idea to step back and ask yourself, you know, what would this look like from the other side in order to help yourself understand some of the issues involved here. I think one of the things that you might think naively is that atheism is a relatively new phenomenon. You know, maybe that it came up in the Enlightenment or in relatively recent experience in history. That is not the case, interestingly. You know, as you study theism and atheism, as you study religion, as you study comparative religion, or your own religion, you will see that texts in your religious tradition contain theism and atheism, both from very early dates. Yes, ma'am.
What is comparative religion?
Well, certainly, you know, one difference between the study of religion and comparative religion would be that you're trying to bring in the phenomena of your own tradition. Let's say if you happen to be a Christian, then that's a beginning. Mm-hmm. But you know, the world has many thousands of religions. There are you know, to start, there's about 7 billion people on the planet today, and about 2.3, 2.4 billion of those people are avowedly Christian. 1.6, perhaps, a billion people are Muslim. Perhaps a billion people or so are Hindu. Chinese traditional religions, including Buddhism and Taoism, might number as many as 400 million people. There are perhaps 15, 16 million Mormons in the world today, about the same number, maybe 14, 15 million of Jews in the world today. There are so many different religions, and they you know, connect with historical and cultural lives in the different historical epochs and parts of the world. And all of that, in a way, is fair game. All of that is part of what we're thinking about when we're talking about religion, comparative religion, theism and atheism. The idea that these two subjects, theism and atheism, have the same starting point is in some ways the most important thing to think about with regard to this subject. Now, this cave painting in Australia, Western Australia, is thought to date from about 60,000 BC. The Lascaux horse and the caves in Altamira and Lascaux are 35,000, 40,000 BC. This figurine, the Venus figurine, is thought to be perhaps 18, 20,000 BC. So we're talking about the evidence of some sort of religious thinking, or at least scholars, anthropologists, take these items to have found an expression for something like spirituality or religious feeling or religious ideas in the form of sculpture and painting, and there's lots of other evidence from these periods. And what I'm trying to say is that before we start worrying about theism and atheism, we have to sort of trace our footsteps back on the timeline a little bit. And the timeline that I'm talking about is something like this, which is the beginning of human life on Earth. So, you know, the Earth is thought to be 4 billion years old or so, and very late in the game, our hominid ancestors are in the old Uvai Gorge in Africa, and you know, these dates give you a little bit of the march out of our mammalian ancestors to what is we're thinking of as our species today. And one of the striking things, I guess, about this is that the people, let's say, who lived 250,000 years ago, against the best evidence that we have today, if they were popped into a birthing ward at Emmanuel Hospital here in Portland, and they were brought up by you guys or by one of us here or someone who lives in Portland, they would look exactly like us, they would behave exactly like us, they would have exactly the same talents, abilities, problems, limitations, aspirations, you know, they would be anatomically and behaviorally exactly like us, based on their physiology and, of course, based on whatever we tried to educate them with as parents. So our species has been around for a long time, perhaps 8,000 generations, 8 to 10,000 generations, that's a rough figure. You know, some people say 160,000 years ago rather than 250,000. I've seen different figures. You can look that up and see, you know, the different ideas that people have about that. 40,000 years ago, which is perhaps the period in which some of the art in Australia and in North Africa, in Ethiopia, and Southern Europe, in Spain, and in France, that's the Paleolithic, the Upper Paleolithic Revolution. I'm assuming that maybe you're familiar with some of these terms. You know, there's a kind of a sense of historical progress over archaeological time that brings us to that event, a very important event, in which we're starting to wear clothes and adorn ourselves. We have some jewelry. There's lots of interesting things that people are making at this period. And things that are made in China, let's say, look different than things that are made in Africa or in South America. But nonetheless, you know, these regional differences in culture still seem to show some basic similarities that are identifiably human. There's an interesting book that was written in the 90s called Human Universals by a fellow named Donald Brown. And Professor Brown tries to take a look at all human societies and find out what some common characteristics of all human societies have been thus far. And of course, one of his findings is that religion is such a common theme. One of the things that I think is important to point to as we're looking at this timeline and trying to understand what's going on in the history of early man and how it relates to the subject of comparative religion or religiosity or spirituality is the relationship between how people live and what is going on in their world of thoughts and actions. And, you know, perhaps this idea is associated with the American anthropologist Paul Redin. He's an important sort of pioneer in this field, but French anthropologists Levi-Strauss and the French tradition, I think, tried to make a connection between economic life and all of cultural phenomena that flow from it. So one of the things that you've got to be interested in this subject is what happens when hunter-gatherer societies become city-building societies, and when hunter-gatherer societies discover agriculture. You know, it seems that agriculture is first discovered in river valleys, in Tigris and the Euphrates, the Yellow River, the Nile Valley. And in these places, you know, in the springtime, without any human meddling, plants begin to grow up on the side of the riverbanks, what they call incipient agriculture. And that's typically the Chalcolithic period, a kind of a stage between the Stone Age, or the people used to call the Stone Age, and the Copper Age. And the this transition is important for our history because it's at that period where we see an important change in society. I guess the thesis here, and that is striking and thought-provoking and something that takes some time to sort of to get used to as an idea, is that the kinds of supernatural beings that cultures come up with in history seems to be tied to the nature of their economic system. So a small tribe at the village level living in unreconstructed nature might have ideas about spiritual beings or gods, if you like, but those beings are inconsistently defined. They're evanescent beings, sprites, and ghost-like characters, and of course, in many cases, they're developments from ancestor worship. You could say, in a sense, that in the most distant cultures that we can find, in a way, all of the dead people in that society have been turned into gods. That is to say, all of my ancestors, everyone who came before me, who I am thinking about and who have influenced the way I'm thinking about things today, they are, as it were, gods for me. But perhaps at another stage, a little further on, I'm you know, as I'm hunting, maybe there are things that I do to propitiate gods that will help the hunt. And that seems to be something that was thought about by the people who created the Lascaux Cave. You know, anthropologists think that there's a kind of a fork symbol above the horse, which is thought to be perhaps a symbolic weapon of some kind. So as you're making this painting, you're helping yourself in the hunt to come. It's also interesting, though, that this painting is probably one of the longest construction projects in history, because parts of the painting date from 20,000 years before and after. So in other words, those are layers upon layers upon layers that last over an incredibly long period of time. That's true, generally, of some of these pieces of art. The Bronze Age is probably the most important thing for us to think about in the context of this class. That's where all of the interesting changes take place. And, you know, there's stone, copper, bronze, and iron. Those are sort of the four ages of ancient times, which are sort of a generally accepted way of thinking about ancient history. And it's in the Bronze Age, in Sumer first, and then afterwards in the other river valleys in Africa and in China, and in India, that civilization seems to grow up. Sumer is an interesting example. It's not an Indo-European culture. It's not a Semitic culture. But it's directly in between both those cultures. And it is the site of many wars. And it's at this period in the Bronze Age that those wars start. In a way, you could say that we are still fighting wars in the area of Sumer, historical Sumer, today. And with some of the same partners in crime, you know, some of the Semitic peoples and the Indo-European peoples struggling over what's going on in that area. In the Bronze Age, you have the beginning of agriculture. You have urbanization. You have the domestication of animals. And lots of writers have wondered whether history would have come about differently if different animal populations existed in the space in which Sumer and the Nile Valley civilizations were going on. Yes, ma'am.
Sumer, where? I'm sorry, here we titled the area Sumer.
The Tigris-Euphrates Valley, yes. You know, the
yes.
The Mesopotamia, the area between the rivers. And that area is was rich with animals that could be domesticated. Jared Diamond, for example, the author of Guns, Germs, and Steel, makes a great deal of his case based on the available animals for domestication in the Middle East during the Bronze Age. Another development is big constructions, big buildings, and of course weapons. And it's also at this period that agricultural record-keeping systems are born, and that becomes the first version of writing. So farming and writing and city building go together. And one of the interesting connections is that writing then becomes an opportunity to develop some ideas about the gods and also for skepticism. This quote from the Song of the Harper, which is one of the oldest texts still extant, you know, something that goes back into ancient Egyptian history, perhaps 2000 BC, maybe more, seems to suggest a kind of a skeptical attitude, a this-worldly attitude. If some of you maybe have read the Epic of Gilgamesh, which also dates from this early period, Gilgamesh, you know, he has a friend in Kidu who's pals with, and they like to go out and have adventures and get into all kinds of trouble. And eventually Enkidu dies, and so Gilgamesh makes the journey to the underworld to try to save his friend and bring him back to life, which he is unable to do. At the end of the epic, he's crying, he's unreconciled, there's no happy, you know, rainbow at the story. Instead, there's the sense that death is this limit that we can't deal with. All of our focus should be on this life. And this is a text from the Epic of Gilgamesh is as old to Homer as Homer is to us.
Wow.
This is a very old text. So another piece of the puzzle here is that when the Bronze Age comes and you're moving from hunter-gatherer societies to agricultural societies, you have this vast increase in population, you have cities, you have urbanization, you have hydraulic projects to bring water to large areas that have been irrigated. And you also have probably the biggest change in society that has taken place in human history from matricentric cultures to patriarchal cultures, patricentric cultures. And a lot of work has been done on this in the last 50 years. One of the interesting, I guess, pieces of the puzzle on this is the so-called Kurgan hypothesis, K-U-R-G-A-N. The Kurgans are another name for the Arya, the Starcevo people. There are a lot of names for this people. This is an Indo-European people who traveled south around the year 4500 BC into what is now Sumer, or what was then Sumer, and what is now Iraq, Iran, the Transoxiana region. And they meet up with another group of people who are traveling north from Africa, North Africa, who move up around 4000 BC, maybe 500 years later. What is interesting about this period is that these cultures, the Kurgan cultures, are the first patriarchal cultures. They're very warlike cultures. They're sun worshippers rather than moon worshippers. They destroyed their Stone Age predecessors. They're noted for their burial sites, which have people buried in this position holding weapons in their hands. They also have these cool things called tholos tombs, which are sort of in the shape of a beehive. And the door into which you walk into this tomb is a very large triangle. It looks Egyptian, but it dates from before Egypt and is all over this area. The Kurgans are an early patriarchal culture, one of the first patriarchal cultures. And this change, you know, also goes with some changes in religious life, as it were, you know, the old mother and the worship of the goddess portrayed in the Venus figurine is replaced by a father god, a sky god, a volcano god, a god who rules over an area oftentimes from a mountaintop, and who's a prophet or shaman or priest. The Brahmins in India are sort of their spokespeople. And so you have to imagine the kind of gradual change over a period of hundreds of years in which matriarchal cultures that are organized at a tribal level become these enormous empires that build enormous structures and that have very large populations based on their previous history. And it's also during this period that you have the first sort of towering gods, creator gods, gods who lord over this civilization and also are thought to have created the world. An early example of which is Ea, which is a god name for the father god, the sky god, in Sumer, which is neither an Indo-European nor a Semitic word. So in this period, you know, volcanoes play a big role. Mount Sinai, of course, is a traditional site for Yahweh, and then, of course, Mount Olympus is an important site for Zeus, the term meaning bright sky, a weather god from Anatolia who plays such a big role later on. In this same period, as we're moving from tribal culture to urban culture, from matriarchal culture to patriarchal culture, and from inconsistently defined kind of godlike or spirit-like entities who might help you with the hunt, or who might preside over childbirth, or who might help young people become initiated into the rites of the tribe, or who preside over the dead, or who preside over the hearth and the home, or who accompany you on your hunt, or who help you in searching for a mate. All of these sort of minor deities become much less important, and new large creator gods, scary gods of the sky, are ensconced in huge constructions, big temples. The picture on the upper right is a reconstruction of the Temple of Herod in Jerusalem, which perhaps is what that looked like in 600 BC or so. But you know, in general, it's during this period that very large kinds of constructions devoted for religious purposes, at least partly for religious purposes, are what we see in this period in history. And of course, in the Iron Age succeeding the Bronze Age, advances in technology make possible even larger constructions. But you know, as it were, the temple becomes a focus for religion. And the temple is, you know, the anthropologists refer to this period as temple religion. So the temple is the residence of this god on earth, is the place where this god has descended to the earth and is doing his thing or her thing on earth. And so as it were, the god is located in a certain place. You know, in the Israelites, if you've studied the Bible, you know that before they have a temple, they have the ark, and the ark is covered by a tent. And many of the names of God in ancient Hebrew have to do with tents and with shielding something from the elements. But for at least 500 years, the Israelites are worshiping their very stark, nameless God without a temple, but then they build a temple. And this period is an important period in the history that you're studying. Now, you recall the idea that, you know, agricultural record systems become the basis of writing. An early date for that is maybe 7,000 BC. By 6,000, 5,000, 4,000 BC, we have these large constructions. We have writing systems in China, in Mesopotamia, in North Africa. And they are all pictographic kinds of writing systems. And in general, the priests who preside at these temples have an important role both in agricultural record keeping and also in developing this new form of writing. You know, there's an interesting story in Plato's Phaedrus where Socrates is talking about the invention of writing in Egypt, and the story goes that the god Thoth brought this to the Pharaoh to say, you know, I have found a way to draw sounds, and I'm giving this to you, Pharaoh, so that you can record whatever thoughts that you have in your culture. And Pharaoh is skeptical. He doesn't think this is a great idea because people will no longer exercise their memory very well, so the invention of writing will actually retard intellectual progress, he says, in the year 1000 BC. But in any case, so during this period, there's the development of writing, and it's, as it were, married to temple religion, and in a sense, that's important because the hierarchy that has been built up to create these structures and that has created these writing systems is also a caste system. One of the big differences between patriarchal cultures and matriarchal cultures is that matriarchal cultures are egalitarian, they don't make war against other matriarchies, and they are relatively democratic in the way they are organized. There's no evidence of war on any large scale amongst matriarchal cultures from, say, 40,000 BC and earlier. And remember that we have stone tools that cultures made from 1 million BC, from 2.5 million BC. So we have a lot of evidence to look at over a long period of time, a long stretch of time. And these matriarchal cultures, you could say, are incredibly stable, not warlike, egalitarian. But as the temple religions begin, agriculture, large building construction, you also have a caste system that goes with them. And all of the early temple religion cultures are caste cultures. And there's a very strict stratification of society, at the top of which are the priests, who are also the authors of the sacred texts that describe and elaborate the nature of the divine beings that preside over these cultures. So these phenomena occur together. They're important pieces of the puzzle to think about together. Now, a next step is that the temples are destroyed over time. You know, for example, in Israel, the Jerusalem temple is destroyed in 586 BCE when the Babylonians get into a conflict with the Israelites, and that's actually the second destruction of the temple. There's an earlier destruction of the temple in 722 BC. But the idea is that, you know, if God is residing at a certain place on earth, on a temple, and then that temple is destroyed, we have a problem. Yeah. And that is one of the interesting, important moments in this history that we have to think about. The term phanum, you know, there's the word profane. The phanum is the temple. And so what is profane is what is in front of the temple, outside of the temple, outside the periphery of the temple, whereas what is sacred is what's inside the temple. You know, we're all used to the word fanatic. Fanatic is also from this root. In a sense, a fanatic is someone who's inside the temple and can't get out. The idea of the word theos, you know, from which this class gets its name, atheism, theism, is D-H-E-S as an Indo-European root. That is the root of the term phanum as well. So the Also, the term fiesta, fete, all of the words that have to do with festivals and in different Indo-European languages come from this root. So the temple is destroyed, and what happens historically is that that's the juncture at which the god is no longer identified with his specific place on earth. And in a sense, the writings become more important, but also the inner subjective sort of feelings that a person has who belongs to the cult, who is part of this religious tradition, they become more important. They're something that you carry with you wherever you happen to be. So you don't necessarily have to do something at the temple in order to be part of the religious tradition. You can carry this tradition around with you, you know, as it were, carrying Jerusalem in your heart or carrying some kind of place of great importance. The Kaaba, for example, in Mecca, you know, is another great site like this from a time of, you know, great antiquity, not a site that's been destroyed. You know, and the Kaaba is thought to be, which is, by the way, a huge sort of cube, and the English word cube is derived from the Arabic term Kaaba, interestingly. It's a huge cube made of a meteorite, carved out of a meteorite. And this is another sort of basis for temple religion in ancient times. And in the destruction, at least in many cases, of temples, writings become important. Carrying the idea of God and your allegiance to your spiritual tradition becomes important. This is also something that Carl Jaspers and Karen Armstrong and lots of writers who have written about comparative religion, they're particularly interested in this particular change, because at this point, this is where people talk about the Axial Age or the Great Transformation. And I guess in a nutshell, you know, your service to the god previously would be to go to the temple and sacrifice. But if the temple doesn't exist, you have to find a different way to serve. And, you know, the historical records that we have show that some of the first ideas that people have about ethics and morality and treating strangers with some kind of compassion and courtesy and granting rights to someone who is outside the immediate area of the cult, and also showing some compassion for people with one troubling condition or another, it's at this point that there's an association is made between ethical behavior as a way of serving God, as opposed to animal sacrifice in the temple as a way of serving God. That is the so-called Great Transformation, the axial change, the change from service as a kind of sacrifice and as a ritual action to service with some moral tinge or some ethical sensibility that's part of it. Also, it's in this period that paganism gets associated with the location of the god at a single point on the earth rather than being everywhere. So this is a kind of a place to begin to think about, well, what is the relevance of all of this history to the problem of theism and atheism today? And perhaps you can see this already, but to me, one way of thinking about this is that religions didn't develop intellectual traditions until relatively late in the game, or spirituality or religiosity did not express itself as theism or atheism as we understand those things today. Certainly the people who painted the caves in Lascaux, the hand paintings in Western Australia, which have some kind of religious significance, and it seems that there's a consensus about that in amongst scholars and anthropologists and historians. Certainly those phenomena all have religious significance of one kind or another, but there's no belief system attached to them. There's nothing that you could call a creed or something that you would have to do, something that you would have to believe in. Instead, there's dance, there's song, there's communal celebration, there's a ritual actions that you perform together, perhaps in tribal cultures at a very small sort of scale. But even at the beginning of temple religion, there's really no intellectual tradition to go with all of this pomp and circumstance surrounding religion. Instead, there are rites. But as the matriarchal cultures fall and patriarchal cultures are born, writing systems come in, and priests and are sort of commandeering power at the head of a caste system that they are directing, which controls the sustenance of the society, the wealth of the society, and the way in which the society structures itself, how it educates its young, what it does with people who break its traditions and taboos. It's at this point that we have the beginning of intellectual traditions, sacred writings, and also it's at this point that there are the first expressions of atheism. And so at the same time that you're moving out of prehistory and a kind of religiosity that expresses itself in rites and in dance and in song, you're also moving into an area where you have sacred writings, now you have belief systems that that we are asked to believe as members of the cult, or that we challenge and that we reject and that we argue against. And typically, it's the priests themselves, or people from the priestly class, from the caste system, who have created these narratives. These are also the people who create our first atheistic texts. I think the statement that I end with there, theism and atheism are opposite reactions to loss of common world of rights. Think about that for a second. So what I'm trying to say here, and this is not just my work, but the work of many, many scholars who've studied this subject for centuries, is that the history of theism and the history of atheism go together, and they come in together in the Bronze Age as a result of all the changes that I've been talking about, beginning with farming, probably the single most important change, which changes the nature of human society from a matriarchal culture to a patriarchal culture and everything that goes with it. This is the starting point for both our religious traditions with belief systems and father gods, creator gods, and also is the starting point for all of our thinking that we would classify today as atheistic thinking. Doubt. Belief and doubt start at the same place. So, an early form of thinking along these lines on both scores is in China. So, China has a written tradition that is at least 5,000 years old. The I Ching, has anybody here ever looked at the I Ching? The I Ching is a book of divination, so you can ask it a question, gee whiz, what should I do? Should I get married? Should I buy a house? Should I quit my job? Should I go to school? And you today you would throw coins, three coins, six times, and you will get a hexagram, which will describe a configuration of a hole in broken lines. And this configuration will allow you to read a poem. And the poem also has some commentaries on each line of the poem. And it's an attempt to sort of perhaps help you make a decision about this difficult thing that you're facing. And this book, which is one of the oldest books in existence, is thought to have its roots in Fu Ci, who's the sort of legendary first emperor of China, who designed the hexagrams, it is said, while he was languishing in a prison cell. And in any case, in the old days, instead of a coin toss, they had yarrow stalks. Yarrow is a plant sort of like fennel, which grows here in Oregon. And they would cut up 48 stalks of fennel and throw them on the ground. And then they had a ritualistic way of removing the stalks that had been thrown on the ground. And what were left were six stalks of fennel, which then would describe a hexagram. This book, the I Ching, is interesting because previous to this, in ancient China, you have a very different way of looking at the universe. One of the things that I think that they have still at the Portland Art Museum are tortoise shells, ancient Chinese tortoise shells. What they would do is, there's these enormous tortoises in central China that are native to that area, and people would catch them and eat them. But the shells, they would take the shells and they would heat them over open fires. And the cracks that appeared in the tortoise shells were thought to be divinations of events yet to unfold. So it was a way of sort of predicting the future, understanding the future. And so Fuzi, as it is said, designed the hexagrams of the I Ching based on the cracks that appeared in tortoise shells in what is the Shang dynasty in China. And so in a way you can see that if I'm consulting a tortoise shell or I'm consulting this divination technique, it's a kind of technology, it's a kind of science, as it were. I'm trying to interpret nature based on conducting an experiment. You know, it's an unusual experiment by our standards, but nonetheless, it's a kind of an experiment. It's a way of consulting nature, and it's at this juncture of approximately 5,000 years ago that Chinese culture makes the transition from a father god and mother goddess to impersonal forces of nature, yin and yang, dark and light, male and female, whose interactions can be studied as scientists study natural forces. You know, instead of having the four fundamental forces of nature as we have today in physics, they had two fundamental forces, wind and water. And wind and water combine to do interesting things, and you can try to figure out what that is. They have a guild, a kind of priestly class. The Fang Shi, whose job it was to interpret I Ching tosses and also explain natural phenomena to the kings of their time. In India, around the same time, you know, Jainism probably is the world's oldest religion. They have the names of figures in Jainism from early periods like Fuzi, someone from 3000 BC. And Jainism and Buddhism, perhaps I should back up. You know, so in India, ancient India, you have a river valley culture also, the Mohenjo-Daro culture. And this is another meeting of the Indo-European peoples who are coming from what is now the steppes in the Soviet or in the Russian Federation, and to Vainu people, who were the native inhabitants of India, northern India at the time. And the combination of the Vainu culture and the Indo-Europeans, the Kurgans, creates one of the first ancient civilizations, the Mohenjo-Daro civilization. And this civilization is associated both with Jainism and with the Vedic culture, with what we call Hinduism. And so at a very early period in history, the Jains are developing their spiritual traditions. And the Rig Veda is another one of the very oldest texts that we possess, which is at least 1700 BC. I've seen figures much older than that for that, but you know, look that up and get some different ideas from scholars about the age of these texts. What's one of the interesting things about the Rig Veda is that it's a Bible. It's a kind of a creation story. It has gods. It has sort of demigods and relationships between human beings and demigods, which forms the background of the Mahabharata, which is a kind of a story for Indian culture similar to the Trojan war for Western culture. It's two families who are at war with each other, but these families are related. So it's like brother against brother. And in the background, of course, there's also gods against gods who are also related. But one of the interesting things about the Rig Veda, far older than texts we have from other cultures, is that at the same time that it expresses its creation myth, it throws doubt upon it. And it seems to suggest that this is our way of understanding. This is our trial balloon. Let's give it a shot. This may be the case, but it may not be. So it doesn't insist upon it the rightness of the text, which is a strange and sophisticated idea for a text that is 4,000, 4,500 years old. Also, in Jainism, there are lots of ideas about God and divinity and deity, but all of those titles have to do with human beings. Those are statuses of human beings, not of otherworldly creatures. You know, some of you probably are also familiar with the idea of ahimsa, nonviolence, which Gandhi made at the basis of his political and ethical position. And that is a term that was developed in Jainism. In Buddhism, you know, which dates from a later period, Buddha is a 6th century BC figure, northern India, Siddhartha Gautama Sakyamuni, the prince of the Sakya clan. He is another interesting figure for this subject because he's not an atheist. It would be incorrect to say that Buddha is an atheist or that Jainism is an atheist position. But he says that questions about God, as he says, tend not to edification. That is to say, it wouldn't matter whether there were gods or not. It has no relevance whatsoever to the quality of our lives. It has no meaning, significance at all for how we would go about living our lives. The problem of life is the problem of suffering. And whether gods exist or not, suffering exists. And our task is to lessen suffering, act as if it was real, and do what we can to eliminate it. God doesn't help us with that task from his perspective. I should say, you know, in ancient India, there are six classical systems, and which are called the Astika systems. They're all based on the Vedas, and they are all, as it were, orthodox positions. They're accepted positions. They're religiously sanctioned positions. There's Naya, Mimamsa, Vaisheshika, Yoga, and two others. They have a mathematical basis. The Naya system, an atomistic philosophy. You know, the world as created by atoms, as consisting of atoms. They have different passages that they point to as the basis of yoga. You know, and the spiritual tradition of yoga. These six systems are all, as it were, okay from the standpoint of sacred texts. There are other three other positions that are called the Nastika systems, from which we get our word nasty, which is interesting. They are Buddhism, Jainism, and the Carvakas. The Carvakas is a third group of writings from this very early period, which are expressly atheist writings. It's a materialistic philosophy that teaches this worldly ethic and a kind of a scientific approach to experience.
Steve, can we do a quick break?
Yes.
So we'll do a quick break. If you have questions, you can...
So another aspect of this history that we're talking about in India at this period, you know, with the six orthodox systems and the three unorthodox systems, those are also called the school of self-reliance and the school of sacred texts. And in a way, that's an interesting distinction that applies to other religious traditions and much else in this history we're looking at. I guess, in a way, what it's saying is that at an early period in religiosity, there's one focus that it talks about human self-responsibility and self-reliance and sort of the relationship between the individual and his or her values as determined by oneself. You know, certainly in Buddhism and in Jainism and the Carvakas, there's that approach. So that I would get things right, as it were. I would figure out how to live an ethical life by my own lights. But at the same time, the Vedas constituted orthodox knowledge. You know, the word Veda itself means knowledge. so that, you know, there's the idea that rather than arriving at an ethical life or at the truth by myself, that I would do so through these sacred texts. So in China and in India, as in other places in the world, at an early period in history, there's this division of opinion as to whether self-reliance or reliance on a sacred tradition is the path for realization. So now, you know, we're beginning to move over to Greece, which plays such an enormous role in our lives. I mean, everything that I've been studying in the last 40 years of my life, I would say, is due to my exposure to the Greeks and my studying the Greeks and learning the Greek language and studying Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, who have no equals in intellectual history for us or for any other people. And they are hugely important for the way we think about the world, for the questions that we ask, for the really the minds that we're carrying around. You know, Thales, as they say in Greek, is one of the first sort of names that comes up in intellectual history. Someone who thought perhaps that differently, or Thales and Pythagoras. You know, the Pythagorean theorem you're familiar with. Mm-hmm. Thales and Pythagoras were contemporaries. They lived on the island of Samos off the what is now Turkey, the sort of middle coast of Anatolia, Turkish coast, and a tyrant who was the archon of their colony in Samos sort of tossed them out, and they went to different places. Eventually, Pythagoras migrated to Italy and started a school there. But Thales and Pythagoras are also interesting because they created new kinds of intellectual traditions. You know, Pythagoras created a religious group, a cult, in which there were, you know, secret knowledge, in which there were initiation rites, and there was a master-student relationship in which you were supposed to pay important respect to the person, the priest, the seer, the prophet, the person who is important and is delivering important knowledge to you. Thales did, in a way, the opposite. He created an intellectual tradition in which the game was to challenge what the other person was saying, in which you were supposed to think about what your teacher, Thales, was saying. You know, he taught, for example, that everything was composed of water. But Thales has his student Anaximander. Anaximander has a student Anaximenes, Heraclitus, Parmenides, Xenophanes, and many other thinkers from the pre-Socratic period. One of the interesting things about them is that they write in their own name, and they're arguing with other people. They're saying, Pythagoras had it all wrong. Thales had it all wrong. You know, this is the way we should look at it. So they're contending with one another. You know, as Karl Popper, the historian of science, puts it, at this early period, Thales creates the tradition of conjecture and refutation, a way of thinking about intellectual life in which you establish a thesis and then you test it and see if it makes any sense. So, you know, at this early period, you know, 7th century BC in Greece, we have the beginnings of mathematics, of astronomy, of cosmology, of philosophy, also of theology and of atheistic traditions, all sort of an interesting brew of ideas that's coming up in and which starts in the city of Miletus, a colony in southern Anatolia, in what is now southern Greece, perhaps the birthplace of philosophy as we know it today. And Miletus is an interesting city. One thing that they did is they established an outpost in Egypt. So there was a Miletan colony under one of the pharaohs, and they brought back knowledge from Egypt to Miletus. They also made inroads to the Middle East and to the Thracian peoples in the north, and to the Etruscans in northern Italy. So they're the first people sort of to develop a cosmological, cosmopolitan society you know, a society, a metropolitan kind of a society, with people speaking many different languages, different customs. They dress differently. They worship different gods. They had very different ways of burying their dead, of eating. They ate different foods. But they all lived together for a period of time in the same place. And out of that interesting mixture of ideas and customs comes philosophy. And, you know, Xenophanes is an interesting thinker, perhaps the first comparative religion scholar, who is struck by the fact that the gods that people worship look so much like the people themselves. And so he says, you know, if oxen worshipped gods, then no doubt the gods would look like oxen, and so on. And, you know, this is an interesting sort of jump of mind for someone in the 6th century BC in Greece. These five fellows, Anaxagoras, Democritus, Protagoras, Diagoras of Milos, and Lysias, were members of the Kakodaimonistae, which are the hellfire guys. Basically, what they would do is that they would meet on days that were thought to be unlucky. You know, like they were they loved the number 13, and they liked to walk under ladders and break mirrors, and they would meet on days in which meeting was in public was forbidden. They went out of their way to challenge religious custom of their time. And they, Diagoras in particular, the fourth picture there, had a reputation as perhaps the most strident atheist in this period. All of them are as it were pre-Socratic figures, people who are wrestling with questions that we now think of as scientific questions or natural science. But they're all also interested in the state religion of Athens and of some of the other cities that they spent time in. But, you know, in a way, they're like the first people to go out of their way to challenge religious custom, and they thought that it was important to do so. And this quote from Critias, who's another member of this club, I'll give you some time to look at this. This is, in a way, the most striking statement of an atheistic thesis from ancient times. And it, you know, in a way, if Critias is an odd person to have put this together, some of you may know some of Greek history. You know, there's the Peloponnesian War between Athens and Sparta, and at the conclusion of the war, Sparta wins. They destroy Athens. They knock down all its walls, its temples, and they install a dictatorship in Athens, which is referred to as the 30 Tyrants. Critias is the head of the 30 Tyrants, and he was a student of Socrates, and he was a I guess he would be among the 1% today, you know, definitely a 1% guy. But in any case, he is also a fearless critic of custom. You know, maybe those go together because his unusual status in society gave him a sort of a picture of society as if he were outside society. But he thought to himself, you know, where did all this belief in God come from? And his explanation is that, you know, in the past we've had authority sort of to scare people into moral behavior, but at some point in history, some clever person thought of the idea of a witness to your deeds, who you can't see, who lives in the clouds and in the beautiful sky where such a being would naturally live, and who not only sees what you do out in public, but even knows what your thoughts might be, and of all of the horrible things that you're thinking right now, you know, as you're sitting in this class. And so he thought perhaps that this was the best explanation for the birth of religious theory to begin with. In a way, that's kind of an introduction to Socrates. You know, all of these figures are considered to be Socratic figures. Socrates, you could say, perhaps is the central person in Western intellectual history, perhaps in world intellectual history. I would argue so. I think Peter would too. You know, Socrates, who was Critias' teacher, of course, is not a member of the sophistic movement, the sophists or the pre-Socratics, who charged for their instruction. You know, they sort of set themselves up in the agora, in the marketplace, and the, you know, like the thing out on the park blocks today, there's all those tents where you can sign up for this and sign up for that. In that epoch, you know, the sophists would be out there saying, you want good grades, you want a great career, you want to succeed in life, come sign up with my program and I'm going to teach you how to do all kinds of great stuff. And Socrates was in those same places, but rather than charging for instruction, simply what he was doing, you know, was asking questions, interesting questions. But one of his appearances, as described in Plato's dialogue, the Euthyphro, is an instructive sort of point in the history that we're looking at. You know, I haven't gotten to talking about the Abrahamic religions yet, but, you know, perhaps some of you know the story of Abraham and Isaac. God commands Abraham to take his son to Mount Moriah, where he is testing him. He's going to see whether or not Abraham has the strength to sacrifice his son, if that is the command that his God has given him. And in Plato's Euthyphro, not aware of this story at all, not related, you know, different culture, but the same question arises. Does God want us to do certain things simply because that's his will? Or does God want us to do certain things because those are good things to do? So is something right because God commands it? Or does God command it because it is right? In the Euthyphro, there's a conversation that takes place between Socrates and this fellow Euthyphro, who's kind of an interesting, weird character, who is prosecuting his father for homicide. His father witnessed the murder of one slave by another, and he wasn't quite sure what to do, so he had the slave who committed the murder thrown into a ditch, and then he went to consult the priests at the Archon court in Athens to figure out what to do. But by the time he got back to the ditch that he had thrown the slave in, the slave had died. So Euthyphro, his son, saying, "Hey, Dad, wait a second. That was not uncool. You can't, you know, just throw this guy in a ditch and kill him. That's a sacrilege. I'm going to prosecute you for impiety. The penalty for which is death in this society. You know, their society is very different than ours, but they did have, you know, a law court. They have a procedural sort of a way of going about this." And in the Euthyphro, I think you have one of the first sort of evidences that ancient peoples asked themselves this question, whether our religious traditions are based on some moral sentiment, or whether our moral sentiments come from our religious traditions. It's a question people still debate today. Now, of course, Socrates is eventually accused of atheism himself, of impiety. And as you know, he goes to court. He offers a defense of himself, which is called the apology. And then there are a number of dialogues which record some of the last stages of his life. And this is the charge that was leveled against him. Socrates violates the law by corrupting the youth and by not believing in the gods of the state, but other new divinities of his own. These other new divinities, he refers oftentimes to what he calls his daimonion, which we translate today as conscience. So he's hearing the voice of conscience in his own head. And that was thought to be a new god that was being introduced into this society that challenged the existing gods. But, you know, another question to ask, you know, is Socrates an atheist? You know, Professor Boghossian may talk about this in the subsequent sessions of this class. You know, there's a lot of debate about that. My own opinion is that I don't know if he's an atheist by our standards or not, but you know, one of the epochs of this history that we're looking at is a kind of atheism that goes after belief. So if I know that you believe something, I feel it's incumbent upon me to attack those beliefs to see if they can really stand up to scrutiny. But Socrates is very gentle with people's superstitions. He doesn't challenge their superstitions. He sort of goes with it. He has a kind of a ironic attitude towards people's superstitions, really towards everything, but certainly with regard to, you know, so for example, he wouldn't challenge someone's belief that outside the city walls in Athens there were wood sprites who protected the forest and you know, Lady Artemis was there shooting her arrows in case you did something bad. He would accept a story like that and perhaps find a way to bring it in ironically to a conversation in which he was challenging the person's beliefs. But he is, I suppose, history's first martyr to the question of theism and atheism, since his execution was specifically on the question of atheism. He was executed by drinking hemlock after being convicted of the charge of impiety. The jury at the time was 400 and some people, big jury, and he only lost by about 30 votes, so he didn't do too bad. But in any case, he lost, and he was executed. So his student Plato is, of course, the main source that we have for any knowledge about Socrates. And he's also someone who is interested in this question of theism and atheism. I guess you could say that Plato is a kind of a moral theologian. He has, what he's done in his dialogues, especially in his later dialogues, is create a brand new theology that is very different than the state religion of Athens of his time. It's a kind of philosophical religion, as it were, in which God is no longer a thundering fellow who's up in the clouds sending bolts of lightning to sinners, but instead is a thoughtful planner of the universe who smiles down upon us ironically as we do all the stupid things that we do. And but he also comes up with ideas about so-called practical atheism, that is to say, regardless of what people say, most people seem to live their lives as atheists in the sense that they have no values, as in his description, and that they're living lives of vice rather than devoting themselves to the only thing that is worth anything at all, which is virtue. So in a sense, he's discovered a new kind of atheism that it would be sort of contemporaneous with the discovery of hypocrisy. Aristotle, Plato's student, and Aristotle is, of course, Alexander's teacher, and Alexander conquers this known world of the time, is also someone who's interested in gods and has a kind of an anthropological, a cultural studies perspective on religion. He's interested in what he calls barbaros philosophia, philosophies of alien people, barbaric philosophies. And he notes the different religious customs that exist in the Mediterranean world of his time, and makes a statement about how different cultures arrange the heavenly host there. Epicurus, Epicurus, one of the Hellenistic philosophers, after Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, the classical period. You have Socratic schools, and then the four schools, the cynics, the skeptics, the academicians, the academy, the peripatetics, Aristotle's school, the Epicureans, and the Stoics. These are all different schools. In a way, they're philosophies and different schools of philosophy. In a way, they're also religious traditions. And the relationship between people who belong to these schools is very similar to what, let's say, a Christian might be to his or her belief tradition today. So it wasn't simply a set of beliefs, but it would also be who you were hanging out with, and the activities that you were taking place in your daily life. Epicurus wants to cure people of theism. He's specifically going back to ideas from Socrates in particular, but also from Xenophanes, and thinks that the way to think about this is through morality, through ethics, and this argument, the so-called moral argument against God, this is perhaps its first statement, from the 4th century BC. So there's so much suffering that exists in the world. If God is omnipotent, then how is that possible? David Hume, for example, a modern philosopher, uses this same argument many centuries later. Lucretius, another Hellenistic philosopher thinks that he can solve this problem by teaching another kind of discipline in place of religion, which he calls ataraxia or apatheia. So the Hellenistic philosophers looked at emotions as the emotional consequences of intellectual judgments, of cognitive judgments that we make. So you only have an emotion if you've made an intellectual decision. And if you are, so if you're angry about something, it's because you've made a decision that something is bad. If you are happy about something, it's because you've made a decision about something that is good. And this decision, the Greek term for that is prohairesis, which the Stoics and the Epicureans and Hellenistic philosophers use. They identified this thing, prohairesis, which we translate as choice, with the authentic self. So that the real me is my choices. And if I can't control what happens in the world. I can't control what people are going to do to me or what people are going to think about me. But what I can control is my assent to a proposition. So, as thoughts arise in my mind, there's, from his perspective, Lucretius' perspective, there's two pieces of the puzzle. There's fantasia, which is like the stuff that you see in your head, or the things that you feel emotionally. But then there's katathesis, which is the assent. So it's like, if I think, today is Monday, that might be the thought that comes into my head, but instead of assenting to it, I say, no, today isn't Monday, today is Thursday or something like that. And the so in each case, I can't control what fantasies, what kind of thoughts move through my mind, but I can control what I assent to, and in that sense, I'm sort of developing an authentic self, separate from the conventions of my society, separate from religious traditions, a sense of peace, reflective calm, and freedom from troublesome thoughts. Now we're moving to the Middle East, and atheism is stated in the Old Testament in many places. These are just some citations where there's a discussion about atheism or the word or something like the word atheism is used. One of the students asked me earlier, what's the sort of the timeline for the Bible? Maybe I can say just very briefly that modern scholarship considers the Bible to be a construction that begins at around 1000 BC. There are four authors of the Bible, J, P, E, and my mind's going. But these different developments of biblical text are happen over an enormous period of time, over 1,000 years, in which finally we arrive under King Josiah in the third century with a Bible that is very the Old Testament. It's very like the Old Testament that we have today. But and some of the oldest parts of the Bible come from Mesopotamian sources. There's the Song of the South, which is in Exodus, that's a very old piece of this tradition. There's also some common language in the Gilgamesh epic and in Exodus and Numbers. Utnapishtim is the name that they use in the Gilgamesh epic for the figure that we call Noah. And the same text appears to be in both these traditions. Which is one way of dating some of these narratives. But over a period of time, an oral tradition is sort of codified, and the early books of the Bible, which to the Jews, are called Tanakh. There's the Torah, there's the Nevi'im, the prophets, and there's the Ketuvim, that's sort of the commentary books. And these traditions come together and are sung at festivals beginning around 720 BC. And then there are additions to these traditions later. And in these early periods, in the 8th century BC, there are mentions in these texts of atheistic ideas. Not with agreement, but they are mentioned. You know, the fool says in his heart, there is no God. That is a phrase that you see in this early form of Judaism. You know, I could spend a lot of time with ancient texts, but I thought I'd move now into the medieval period. One of the most interesting figures in the medieval period, to me anyway, is Al-Razi, who is the founder of Western medicine. You know, it used to be that around the turn of the century, when you were a med student, the first book that you read was Liber Continens, which is the sort of the collection of understanding of medical traditions from ancient times, from Galen and Hippocrates. Razi was the director of a hospital, and he was a physician. He studied infectious diseases. He founded ophthalmology. He is an incredible sort of autodidact, someone who knew virtually everything that could be known in his period of time. But he's also a skeptic in terms of religious traditions, and he got into trouble a lot of times with his traditions because of his skepticism. For example, the last quote is a fairly straightforward skeptical position that he's stating: how can anyone think philosophically while committed to old wives' tales, founded on contradictions, stubborn ignorance, and the scourge of dogmatism? It's pretty straightforward. This is not he was such an important person in his society. He was such a helpful person who was curing people and developing medical traditions that, far in advance of what was available in any other part of the world at the time, that he was safe somewhat in his position of skepticism. That's a question to ask, a kind of a time out for 1 second on that, which is, atheism, of course, is only possible if you have political traditions that allow a person to speak his or her mind. Institutions make religious studies possible. You know, even today in some parts of the world, the lecture that I'm giving would be punishable by death, I'm sorry to say. You know, so religious freedom isn't something that comes just like that. You have to fight for it. And one of the strange things about Islamic culture is that there's these enormous intellectual giants that are part of the founding of Islam, like Razas and many others. But their gigantic status didn't translate into institutions that it made it possible to criticize what had gone before. Thales is such an interesting figure because he's founding a school and a way of thinking, but he encouraged people to challenge him and to challenge the ideas that he was putting forward. That's the difference. Institutions that allow a person to challenge. You know, if I'm not allowed to challenge the Prophet and the Holy Quran, then I'm intellectually sort of in a boxed in place. Razas tried to break out of that place. So did Abu Ala, another figure from early Islamic history, who did not end well. A lot of the people, sort of early figures in skepticism and atheistic thought in the medieval period, in Judaism, in Christianity, and Islam, do not end well. You know, challenging hierarchy, challenging orthodoxy is a dangerous business. Perhaps most famously in Christianity in the medieval period, there's the ontological argument and the challenge to the ontological argument. The ontological argument goes like this. It was discovered by Anselm of Canterbury. Anselm of Canterbury, hugely interesting figure. Here's somebody who was born in Italy, but becomes the Archbishop of Canterbury in England. How is that possible? Because the most important thing in their lives was the church. It's like an Italian scientist coming to MIT and working on neutrinos or something. The center of their life was church doctrine and ideas and, you know, bringing understanding to the sacred traditions. So this humble son from a small town in Italy becomes one of the most important people in the world of theology of his time. So his argument is, God is that which no greater can be conceived. God is like the biggest thing, the greatest thing, the most amazing thing that can be conceived. Let's start with that as a definition. And if you compare that to the same idea but add existence, then the one in which you have added existence is greater than the first. I could be the greatest, we could imagine the greatest teacher of all time, the wonderful teacher, or the greatest husband or wife or president or hot dog maker. But if you added the idea of existence, then not only would be that would be great an idea, but it would actually exist, which is even better. So he is saying that because God is the greatest thing that we can conceive of, and because if we don't include existence in the idea of God, we have diminished the idea of God. Therefore, necessarily, God exists. This argument, when he came up with it, so pleased him that he offered a sacrifice to God, and there was a great celebration at his abbey. But a contemporary of his, who is pictured in this little cartoon here, Gonilon, another Italian living in France, Marmottier, thinks to himself, well, wait a second. What about like the coolest island of all time? You know, the best place to go that you can think of. If we compare that to the same thing, but adding existence as another property, then
we have 1 minute. Sorry.
1 minute.
1 minute, and then we've got
end of the class.
Yeah.
I'm only like halfway through.
You'll have to come back.
All right.
Come
so here's the rest of the show really quick. Here's some more medieval people. You know, Amaury of Bene and David of Dinant. Both executed. They're both early figures of atheism. Then I was about to get into modernism. Here's a list of a lot of interesting modernist thinkers. Atheism, you know, there are psychological theories, social theories, historical theories, and biological theories trying to explain what atheism is, and also trying to understand religion. One of the interesting responses in theology is after atheism has been developed, especially in the 19th century with figures like Nietzsche and Feuerbach and Schopenhauer, that you have a new kind of theism that is based on the idea of the death of God. And that's what some of these figures, Paul Van Buren, Mark Taylor, and the contemporary Italian philosopher Gian Teresimo Vattimo, a very interesting thinker who's still around, and what they're doing is trying to look at theology and theism, but accepting the idea that God has died. Another couple of guys who are interesting in this history are Rudolf Bultmann and Paul Tillich, two Protestant theologians. Bultmann had the idea, okay, let's take religion, let's demythologize it. Let's take all of the magical stuff out. No virgin birth, no resurrection, no walking on water, none of the Eucharist and all that. Let's just try to turn it into a moral teaching. And Paul Tillich, born in Germany, died in Indiana, tries a similar approach, you know, focusing, let's not read the Bible as a literal description of fact. Let's read the Bible and other religious texts symbolically so that, you know, it's as it were poetry. It's a way of sort of helping us understand our mortality and living with it and finding ways to go on in the face of our mortality. That was his point of view. There's something called the New Atheism, and this is a school that is around today. You know, Christopher Hitchens, who died recently, is associated with this. And in a way, the big idea here is to go after theism, you know, hunt it down and try to challenge the place of religion in society and the idea that we can use our religious beliefs as arguments in public discourse. Another step in this history is, and these are some names that are associated with atheism, what atheism has been in the past, you know, so many different things. But I was going to say another stage in this is your professor. taken a very vocal position and tried to enunciate an atheist point of view, you know, clearly and taking on challengers. And, you know, this is what philosophers do. We want to challenge people's thought processes and get into an argument and see if your ideas can stand up to scrutiny. What Socrates called the elenkos, the cross-examination of ideas. And that is exactly what Professor Boghossian is going to do. And perhaps that will help all of you guys, you know, find a way to scrutinize your ideas, whatever they may be, and see if they stand up to scrutiny.
Thank you. All right, thanks everybody.